Right, how are we doing? Welcome back to Licklibrary's YouTube. This is Sam Bell doing another live webinar. And tonight, that's my backing track, available on licklibrary.com. We'll talk about more about that in a moment. We're back, I'm here. And despite that backing track interrupting me, I'm happy to be here. And I hope you're all doing well. Let's just check in on the chat. Who is here? Jason, I hope. All three of these are Steven Seagal solos. Blue Sumlin, Cynthia, good to see you. Ferdy, Block 18, Anthony, Victor, Rebel, the Uncanny, great to see you all. Just going to check in. Kate, good to see you. Hemel Strap, nice. Some familiar names and some new faces as well. Good to see you all. So today, I have been given the task of, three solos you must learn. And I one of the, the perk of teaching for Licklibrary is I get to learn great solos and teach them. But sometimes when I teach them, I kind of forget them because I have to get on with the new ones. So this is actually kind of like giving me an opportunity to kind of revisit some of those awesome solos that I've had the opportunity to learn and share and transcribe in the past. And I want to start this by saying there are loads of great solos, of course. There's all the classics. You've got Hotel California, you've got Sweet Child of Mine, you've got all those Hendrix solos and the classic Stevie Ray Vaughan solos, all these things. And we can wax lyrical about them. But today I wanted to demonstrate three, going through my archives, I've got a handful really to go with. Some of them I can't quite play properly. We'll get to that later on. But they're kind of in pop rock tracks, and they're really melodic, and they've got loads of really cool things in them that we can take and learn from. And when I talk about learning exercises on the guitar, I think the ultimate thing is to actually learn solos that you love and then break them down and learn how to repurpose some of those phrases. And you can do that by a little bit of theory knowledge, a bit of tweaking, a bit of ear, and using backing tracks to force you to use these ideas in different ways. So that's what we're gonna do today. Fantastic. I'm going to check in. Cool. So, right. I've got my list. My list of solos. God, where am I going to start? I'm going to start with I'm going to probably move fairly quickly here, but only because this is a recent one in working memory for me. And it's a solo that, and I recommend you do this. If you have ever had solos that you used to listen to before you play guitar and thought, I should learn that, and you haven't learned it, then what are you waiting for? You need to go and learn it. And one of them for me was the guitar solo from Def Leppard's Photograph. It was just a really cool solo. I loved all the riffs in it and some of the phrases. Let's have a listen. Make sure that my guitar is somewhat in tune, like a professional guitarist. And let me see if I can demonstrate. So we got this. And of course, I'm using the obligatory chorus. Now that's got loads of cool phrases in it. Even just the basic rhythm at the start there, we got, that's just a cool hook. We got that. Now I know this is using the E major pentatonic scale or C sharp minor pentatonic. So I've got that phrase. So that's a cool phrase, starting with that 9th fret G. And it's a great example of, making more out of just two notes there. And a bend towards the end just for, because that sounds cool. And then we've got this. By the way, all the solos I'm demonstrating in today's session are available as full lessons on licklibrary.com. More about that in a bit. So this lick here, that's just a cool phrase. And then we got this. And I love this build at the end. Again, a little bit of a sequence. That by itself, That could sound like a nursery rhyme if I didn't, you know, I could be. But because it's played with some attitude at the right point in the solo, and it builds it to the kind of, he's just kind of picking like mad on those notes. So there's loads of really cool stuff. So one thing to start getting into, you know, let's say you've learnt that solo and you love it and you can play it, you can even jam along with the track, or you can use a backing track and you can play that note for note. That exists as that solo, and I absolutely love playing that solo. It's just good fun. You know, it's good to like try and copy the track as closely as possible, because within that you learn about you know, tone and dynamics and where things sit and vibrato and intonation and all that stuff, but also understanding the contour of the solo beyond even being able to play it. You know, you've got this, I recommend if you listen to any track, you've got that and then so there's actually, it's almost like a marching drum beat, and that's probably one of the reasons why this solo is so catchy. You know, there's not that many notes going on apart from at the end there, but the rhythm is really strong. So a good fun exercise to try. I'm just going to bring this up now. So this solo is E major pentatonic, C sharp minor pentatonic. Now I've got a backing track here on licklibrary.com. This is the E major feel good rock guitar backing track. And I had a bit of fun earlier because there's two things we can do with this, which are quite interesting in terms of practice. And I always think practice should be fun and not a chore. So now I'm going to play the E major feel-good rock version of the Photograph solo. Let's see if it works. And it might not work, and the whole point of this is to get comfortable with trying to fit things in different situations so it's not just locked in the track. See if it works. Might not. Might sound a bit weird. I felt like I was doing like a slow motion going, you know, I was going through the finish line at a marathon and playing the solo in slow motion. So that is one thing you can do straight away, and that takes a little bit, I'm going to say the word, theory. It takes a little bit of theory knowledge, because you have to understand, you know, how that, you know, what the scale is, the patterns that you're using. Now, when I was learning this, something made this easy to pick up, of course, your ear. But putting your ear in with your scale patterns. Yeah, you know, I was thinking E major, but in that position. It's C sharp minor pentatonic. But I can also see my whole major scale. So when we do the... You know, all those little things live inside of there, and you can reuse them. Now, beyond this, I mean, I think it's good to learn the solo, of course. But we can actually use the contours of this solo. So if you've got a guitar in your hand right now, I'd encourage you to try this. We'll try this on an E note, because that's where the solo for Photographs begins. By the way, you can do this for all the solos I'm going to talk about today, and all the solos you know already. So there's a whole world living in them. I like to say that, you know, even learning one song is like 100 lessons. And licklibrary.com has hundreds of song lessons, thousands. And within each one of them, there's tons more that you can get out of them. So it's worth learning these songs and investigating them. Anyway, so we've got that E note on the G string, 9th fret. So what I want to do is see if you can sort of follow along, just keeping that first motif. I see Jason can't bring guitars to work, but one thing you can do, and I think I said this in last session actually, if you can actually sort of hum it, feel it, imagine it, that's also practice. If you're visualizing, neuroscience says that you actually can be practicing the intentionality of playing things. So you can practice at work. So people think you're working hard, but actually you're just shredding solos all day long. Okay, it's all good. And when you pick up the guitar, it'll be there, hopefully, a bit more than it would be if you didn't do that. So take that backing track. So let's have a look. So take it. Right, I was just choosing, obviously the backing track gives us context. I deviated there, went away from E. What I would suggest, maybe something a bit more practical to do, is take any particular scale, C sharp minor pentatonic in this relative minor, E major pentatonic, over this E major feel good rock backing track, and just kind of see if you can keep that rhythm going over the thing. I don't know if the track's too loud, I'm just gonna double check that, here we go. Now, already that, because I've kind of I've practiced that solo. I know it might not sound like it when I first played it, but I promise you I have. But I've got that, and maybe because I've also listened to that solo quite a long time, I've got the rhythms in there. I've got the scale pattern. I'm not doing any weird, you know, weird arpeggios or anything. I'm just playing minor pentatonic, major pentatonic, sorry. You know, just following that rhythm, and suddenly loads of little new ideas came out, because we all have these, especially with guitar, we all have these natural rhythms that we go to. And I reckon half the battle, when we're tired of our playing, it's not necessarily that we need a whole load of new licks or even new highfalutin theory concepts, even though they can be very helpful. It can be actually that the rhythm, and we're not using enough rhythm in our playing in terms of the timing of notes and repetition of phrases and stuff like that. So even a notey solo can give us cool rhythms to try. So hopefully that's good. Blue Sumlin, my vibrato needs work, not quite right. Well, you know, again, playing along to, and now because we're on YouTube, I can't demonstrate me playing along to a actual track because YouTube. But, you know, if you've learned a solo, play along to the solo that you love and really work on just kind of copying that vibrato as closely as you can. Next up, next solo. Okay, this is I love this one. I sometimes do like rough tabs for these just so I can record them a bit later on. So I've got my old one. I haven't had a chance to check this out properly, but this is from Journey. Who's Crying Now is the track, and the lesson, of course, is available at licklibrary.com, and I'll talk about where to find it later on the website, so you can find it. This solo is the outro solo. And this has some great bends. It's got some pedal point stuff in it. And it's simple. Again, the photograph solo is pretty simple, apart from the ending. But there's loads of good stuff in it. This solo is also fairly simple. I wouldn't say it's beginner, but there's loads of really cool phrases. And especially this first bit. See if I can get it. Wish me luck. Here we go. And then it goes. And then we got. Oh, I love this bit. And then we got this other phrase. I can't play it. But there we are. So the main bits I wanted to kind of address of that solo, check it out, because Neil Schon is just like, whoa, great guitarist. I'm sure many of us know of him. This is also pretty good because we can be focusing in that kind of natural minor, E minor. That area. And I don't know why I'm trying to do silly tapping things. There we are. I'm in just teacher mode. So that little opening lick, just super cool, right? And you can see where it comes from. This solo's in E minor, and we've got let's look at the frets there. So you've got 15, 14, 12 on the E, and on the B string we've got 15, 13, 12. And this starts out of a bend from the flat 7 to the root, which is the 15th fret. And then you're grabbing the 15th fret and high E string. And then back down. Cynthia says it sounds like Pachelbel's Canon. Yeah, it definitely has that element to it. Maybe I'm wrong, maybe. I think it's an A minor, I'm really sorry. I should do my thing. It's 13 on the highest string, that's within the scale. So we're in this kind of A minor position. I'm so sorry. But now we've got a phrase. So we're bending up there, we can actually keep that. Wow. So what I'm doing here, now I've figured out it's an A minor. I've got my A minor scale. I know it kind of follows this kind of two string pattern. And if I know my minor scale on the top two strings, I can look for other places where a similar phrase might sound cool. So maybe in position one there. And then, you know, I might employ the, you know, the amazing backing tracks we've got here at Licklibrary. I'm gonna go for this one, actually. This is the subtle and gentle C Lydian guitar backing track. So I've now got to transpose those patterns into C Lydian. So I know, well, I'll see if it's, I'm gonna see how it sounds. So I might try them out in different places. So I know I might look for within C Lydian, those scale fragments which come up. So I could do it here. It works there, because if you think of C Lydian, we've actually got that position up here. And then where's the other one? We got the, oh yeah. And that'll be the top part of the. So working where it is, working out where it's in the key. It might not work, who knows? Try again, that sounds cool. And then up here. That's a cool jam track. Just to remind you, that is the subtle and gentle C Lydian guitar backing track. Really fun. So hopefully you could hear me trying to, you know, crowbar that phrase into there. And sometimes it does literally feel like that. It feels like you're, you know, defacing, you know, a beautiful painting. But the thing is, that's how all artists, all musicians got, you know, ideas. They often learnt from recordings, their favourite players. And they just tried this stuff out until they could find places to use it. And you can use theory to do that. You can use your ear and everything. But both are going to help. They're both going to help you get there quicker. And it's important then to like mess with different elements of that as we go through. So, cool. So, cool. Right, I'm just going to check in on some questions. Nice. Okay. I'm going to address questions towards the end as well. So if anybody has anything super in particular, my laptop's here with all my chat. So I'm not looking away from you, or I'm looking at the chat, but hopefully understand. Anyway, I'm going a bit mad. So, okay. What's another solo? Another really good, easy win for players. I love this one. See if you can name the solo. If you can't, it's either because you don't know it or because I've not played it right, which is more likely. Here we go. And then how did it end? Oh, yeah. There we are. Okay. We can do it. We can just do an overdub at the end there. We'll just track it in. Crossfade it in. It won't sound like a mistake. So that was nothing. Is it nothing's going to stop us now? Fantastic. There we are. Nice one, Ergo. So nothing's going to stop us now. Starship. Great. Really, you've probably heard that 1,000 times on the radio. Even if you didn't want to hear it, it was there. And there's some cool stuff in there. I mean, one of my favourite bits is this whole... let's find it. That's awesome. That's just cool. I mean, it's cool. I love it. So, we're starting off with this is E minor pentatonic, another great solo. All these great solos live with that classic position one pentatonic. So starting off with that kind of double stop. Great opportunity there. There's this whole idea of, a bend, it's kind of loose. And then some kind of in time slides, really articulate, sounding cool. And then we got that. Oh, that's just cool. That could be a... We could make all kinds of riffs out of that. I don't know. I'm writing a hair metal track. There we are. But that pedal point lick is pretty cool. I wonder. Hey, let's see if we can do it over this backing track and see if I can search for ideas. Now, the benefit of using, these backing tracks over these licks is because obviously the solos are often written for the context of the song they're in. And of course, not everything can, nothing's going to work completely the same way. Very rarely, you just slot in. So you're going to have to use your own interpretation. So then it gets you out of just playing the lick verbatim, and it gets you into thinking about how to reshape that lick. So I might see. I mean, it might not work, but we might take that pedal point lick from Starship and we'll see if it do it on the C Lydian track. Here we go. So obviously we're hearing, we've got to get rid of the memory of like how it sounded in the original recording. We now got to treat this as like a new idea, So maybe the rhythm's not quite right for it, so it might be. You might want to sort of play around with the shape. Thank you. then suddenly you've got yourself a new guitar solo. So see where it goes. Just, you can do this in a really academic way. You can go, I'm going to take that note, change the beat. You can write it down. You can send yourself a letter. You can post it. You can receive the letter, see how you feel about it when you receive it again. Or you can just mess around with it like you're just playing with blue tack or clay. You know, you just take the idea, you've got this thing, and then you're just seeing how, you know, what other contours and shapes, where else can that fit? Without getting too theoretical, within the scale systems on the fretboard, you know, that's one way, and your ear starts to tune into that stuff in a cool way. So that's another solo. So we've looked at Starship, we've looked at Journey, we've looked at Photographs. So that's three solos, and I promised you three solos. Now, I'm going to go for it. So we've got this other solo. I want to show you this one. Again, name the solo. Here we go. Woof! The climatic note, I did it up a semitone, but anyway, we can all live and forget that. I love that solo. I actually play that with a theatre production show called Women in Rock. It's really fun. So that's alone, fantastic. So yeah, here we are. So I'm just going to take a sip of water because this one's cool. So awkwardly, I think, I don't know, it's probably, oh, I'm still here. I just need to reset that camera. So this solo actually is in E flat because probably they were tuning down a half step. So I'm actually playing that in standard half step down. So I'm not sure quite, but it's kind of living. Oh gosh, this camera's not playing ball. Let's see if we can get it. Yes, there we are. You can see all of its settings right there. It should disappear in a moment. So seems like I've chosen lots of solos of pedal points, but maybe that's kind of the mood I'm in. But then we've got this some really interesting movements within that pattern. And I'd imagine, I mean, I'm not super good with names of who's playing guitar and that, but the musician that wrote that melody is clearly a written melody. That's very classically, and that's a classical inspired. You know, you can permutate that around the neck in some quite cool ways. So that's it, because I'm looking at them. I'm not used to, I haven't played this guitar in a few days, so that's my excuse. So yeah, we're starting out of that bend thing. And then we have this. This is another backing track, by the way, of mine. This is called Super Bowling Technique. I don't know. It's in B minor. Okay, so let's have a listen, see what happens. Here we go, see if I can play that melody. So several things I tried to go for there. I tried to literally start it the same way, but just down in B minor. But I felt like I needed to kind of give it a tag to kind of go off. I didn't think about that. It kind of just didn't feel right landing on the fourth there. But if I was to analyze what I did from memory. But yeah, so there's that. And then there's that melody that we had within the heart solo. Let's see if I can do some more of that. Mm-hmm. knows what's going on anymore. Whew. So yeah, that's a pretty cool cool solo to get things out of. So we are half an hour in. There are two notable mentions. I couldn't let myself, I don't think I've got time to sort of show them, mainly because I can't quite play them properly, and that's an excuse, because I've literally just kind of got these out again, just to kind of see what solos I would suggest. And we've got Get the Funk Out by Extreme, and there's a lick in there. I'm just going to talk about it just for a moment. So we've got... And then, people always talk about... all that stuff, but actually the lick before that, that thing, oh, when I was filming the classic albums Porno Graffiti course, that really just that was the lick that stumped me up. But there's a phrase after that which is super cool, which goes like this. Now, there's loads in there. One of my favourites, an easy win, is... that's a pretty cool little G minor blues phrase. Quite like that. And I also love that... that's weird. But it's crazy. So that's a notable mention. So learning Get the Funk Out, even if I'm going to suggest, you know, even if you feel that's above, I mean, I think it's above what I'm able to actually do. But you know, if you're starting out and you can play a few of these solos I've mentioned already, and you want to challenge yourself, I recommend even just trying it out, because it's going to push your technique to different levels. And again, I'm a long-haired rock guitarist at heart, and I never had the chance to properly learn this solo, and I tried to learn it in time for today, but I'm just not there. I'm really sorry. But Tornado of Souls by my Megadeth with Marty Friedman. Even just, I'm just going to try to sort of explain some of the cool stuff we got. Then I've lost it. But then we got... something along those lines. There's so much cool stuff in there. And really, when you're learning these solos, you're not just learning these licks. If you repurpose them, that's good. But if you can get the attitude, I think you're actually kind of getting more out of the solo. And that requires kind of, you know, playing along to it, getting... excited about the solo, and just, you know, sounds really cheesy, but just imagine you're performing it, you know, when you're practicing it, just, this is going to count, you know. That's a really nice way of getting it in. So we've covered quite a lot of stuff there. Okay, so let's just recap. I'm going to take some questions in a moment. I've looked at, I promise you, three solos. We've done Photograph, we've done Journey, we've done Starship, we've done Heart Alone, we've very briefly looked at Tornado of Souls, and Get the Funk Out, because I can't not, because they're great. I was also going to put some notable mentions in, like some melodic solos by Paul Gilbert. We've got a great lesson on Green Tinted 60s Mind, which is fantastic. Just so as you're asking some questions, I just want to go into Lick Library just briefly. If you're a member, you can come in here and you can search for these. So if I searched, for argument's sake, Heart Alone, song lesson, there we are. And then right there, we've got the complete song. I'm just going to mute that before it plays. There, look at that guy. He's got short hair, but it was just a misguided time in my life. But there we are. I did a good lesson on that, I think. I think that's quite a cool one to learn. If we can do some more, let's say you want to learn, oh, I don't know, well, Extremes in there, but Tornado of Souls is in there. Full song lesson, all the riffs. There's Mustaine playing a double neck guitar by Dean because he's Dave Mustaine. I mean, come on, you can't not. Now, if some of this stuff isn't quite your cup of tea, there's another great course available, a series of courses that's learned to, there's the solos series. Okay, so this is, there's different artists, there's kind of Gary Moore, there's Thin Lizzy, there's Van Halen, there's, you name most of the kind of players. This is Andy James's course, and he goes through some solos. He goes through Ladies Night in Buffalo, Going Crazy, Elephant Gun, Big Trouble, Bump and Grind. There's loads of classic Vi ones. I'm not saying it has to be Vi, but you could choose one of those. And the great thing about that series is there are three speeds. So he teaches it and performs it at three different speeds, and there's three different speed backing tracks. So if you're, you know, wanting to get something, especially the Vi stuff or the fast stuff, if you want a reference at those speeds, it's a really cool kind of course to go along. And of course, that, you know, Andy James, great teacher. So there's all the solos series, I'd suggest. Whew, I'm going to take a deep breath and I'm going to have a look at some of these comments. Were you a fan of Chris Broderick? I love Chris Broderick, but I'm more of a fan of, Marty Friedman and Jason Becker, because they had Cacophony. Marty Friedman and Jason Becker, they are sublime guitarists, metal guitarists from the 80s. It's really unfortunate. And Jason, unfortunately, can no longer physically play because he has ALS, but he's still composing, which is amazing. So he's an inspiration beyond his, you know, virtuosic technique at a very young age, and made players like Richie Kotzen think twice about their careers when he first met him. He was that good. And then Marty Friedman. I mean, that Tornado of Souls solo is just epic. It's a standard for metal players to learn. And you can tell who's learned that solo. You can tell I haven't, because I know players that like have learned loads of Marty Friedman stuff, and their playing just has this awesome swagger. So it's good to learn from, choose your influences wisely, I'd say. But Jeff Loomis, I love Jeff Loomis, and Jeff Loomis was very much inspired by that movement as well. So yeah, cool. I also like taking 80s pop keyboard solos to learn guitar. Tiffany, I think we're alone now. It's really fun. So that's a great idea. Yeah, learning from keyboards. Another one to suggest if you're up for learning solos from 80s pop other instruments is I think it's Candy by, it's got Michael Brecker. I've forgotten the name of it. Candy. It's that song. Michael Brecker's on it. I've forgotten the artist. Cool. A G minor blues phrase. That's next week spent on that. Then, well, block 18, just to kind of bring that up. Don't worry. You know, like I say, any one of these phrases, it's amazing. If you take that one phrase and do it slowly and then take it over a backing track, and you start, rather than the guitar solo itself being the only place you play that, you start to actually, it starts to become your own rather than, you know, something in that solo. So I think there's lots of great stuff you can get out of that. Cool. Still waiting on Licklibrary to come out with Fred Durst, the solos. Maybe one day. That's good. Fred Durst. My friend, I've got a friend called Doug Steele in Australia, and he did a thing called Shred Durst many years ago in early YouTube eras. It was him being Fred Durst, but shredding over fusion backing tracks. It was great. And talking like Fred Durst. Anyway, so any particular questions? Let's have a look. Has anybody got any? I've got some great, yeah, everyone's got in. You should have a package of backing tracks that you can sell in connection with the live stream. As I have mentioned, they are all just here on Licklibrary and the membership. You've got access to all of these if you search Superb Bowling Technique. There I am with my hair slicked back, and that's one of my ones. We've got this one, C. Lydian backing track. I've forgotten who did this one. Who's this one? I don't know. It comes from the Lydian Mode Steve Vai course. So lots of these courses come with great backing tracks as well. And then that E, the slow version that we did there, is the Danny Gill Harmony and Theory Basics. That might be a good one as well if you're a bit unsure about what I'm talking about in terms of, you know, scales and keys and patterns. That's probably a good place to check out. So yeah, let's have a look at any more comments. Got to run early. Well, good to see you. Fantastic. Hopefully attending Water Bear for guitar in 2025. I'll be 32. Oh great. Well, maybe, hopefully I'll be there, and we'll get down to some guitaring. Nice. Slash the solos would be awesome, says Chris. There is a Slash the Solos, I think. Let's have a look. Let me have a little search. The solos. Come on, come on, don't let me down. Don't let me down. There's tons of Guns N' Roses on Licklibrary. In fact, actually, there's not quite the solos one, but there is plenty of. I mean, I finished a few months ago Use Your Illusion 1. I think Use Your Illusion 2 is all up there as well, every song from the album. So I finished doing all the guitars for the Use Your Illusion 1 a month ago or something. So it shouldn't. Keep an eye on Licklibrary over the next few months, and there might be a new classic albums course. Who knows? Mundane question: what strings do you play, Brandon Gage? Ernie Ball. I'm allowed to buy strings off them a little bit cheaper, so I'm very happy to use them because they just seem to work. I've used Dear Daria in the past as well; they're really good as well. I mean, you know, use what feels good. 10 to 46, and this is an Eternal guitar made by my mate down the road from me here in Chichester in the UK. And I heard something about tone. I am using a quad cortex, and the core tone is very straightforward. I like straightforward tones. Then I got a bit of a tube screamer on top of that. And the pickups, this is like a PAF, and then we've got some things there. And then I got a bit of delay because it helps me sound a bit more professional. I'm not sure how that's sounding your end. It always sounds different, especially if you're listening on a phone. But there we are. Cynthia says, do you know any players who use gold-plated strings? I think Brian May does. I think he has an actual signature set with a company. I'm not 100% sure. Learning note for note is great, but where is the innovation in that? Well, think about how we learn to talk. We learn by copying others. All of our ideas, all the ideas of who we think we are, is based upon what is reflected in the world around us. And in the same way of learning guitar, you can't, to say you don't have influences is to imagine that you're completely separate from the world around you. So I've found it's not to learn note for note for the sake of recital. You learn note for note as a kind of act of love of music. You know, I love learning these solos. I heard them, I liked them, and I just had the natural inkling, like, what is that? And then by learning it by ear, I'm using my own ear and knowledge to pick it up. And then it gives me the satisfaction of not only learning that, like I think I said this in the last live stream, that I feel like, I don't actually literally feel like Indiana Jones, but you know, you're kind of exploring like an archaeologist going back into the music. Oh, they've used this here. And there's kind of a bit of that. And then suddenly you forget it. And then when you're just improvising, and it goes into your melodic toolbox, because everything you've ever heard, you will play. Even the stuff you don't think you know, and the things you don't like, and the things you don't think you're influenced by, they will come out. In fact, sometimes the stuff that you don't want will come in some ways. So, you know, every musician is influenced by something, even if they say they don't. I mean, there's an Yngwie thing. I'm not sure how true it is, because Yngwie is a friend of Licklibrary's, but I think he said something. He didn't listen to many other artists apart from maybe Ritchie Blackmore, and he claimed not to have many other influences. But you can hear loads of influences. You can hear the Bach, you can hear the Hendrix, you can hear all kinds of things. When you hear Hendrix, you're hearing all the blues players that came before him. You know, no one's doing anything completely new. The only thing that's new, in my personal opinion, is the perspective, which is your life. And this is why I really, truly, firmly believe that the best player we can be is ourselves. And, you know, we don't want Slash to be Steve Vai. We don't expect Kurt Cobain. That was another solo I should have done in Bloom. That's a really good solo. Such a cool solo. Kurt Cobain, we don't expect him to be Pat Martino. You know, because otherwise, what's the point? So we don't want people going around being completely carbon copies, but we learn from others note for note to really learn about ourselves, because we are what we are as an entity is relationship with environmental causes, and that's kind of how the world works, that's how nature works, that's how the mind works in many ways. Our thoughts, we don't really control them. If I said to you, think of a color, how do you know what color you're going to think of first? It just comes up. Depends on all the factors that happened before I said that. So influences are important. but healthy, I think, healthy digestion, not getting too lost in them, hero worship and all that stuff, and getting too caught up in being like them, but just learn what interests you. Anyway, that's a really long and probably pretty pretentious answer, so I'm very sorry about that. Cool. Blues, good to see you. Take care. You wouldn't take the... Cool. Thank you for the clarification. Is the quad cortex... Is a quad cortex guitar... No, there's no tips at Licklibrary on how to use a quad cortex, but I do have a series of lessons on Licklibrary looking at the basics of tone and how mics and different amps affect different aspects of sound. Trying to sort of break down the basics of like the core archetypes of pedals and things. It's like a very kind of beginner, not, you know, very surface level look. But when I approach anything like modelling or real amp, there's knowledge of amps is very helpful. Knowledge of how microphones work, knowledge of how loud things can change and different volume levels. You know, like having a super gainy, you know, trebly scoop sound might sound good at low volumes, but loud, it just gets lost. So it's learning how to kind of, you know, kind of tweak those things. So check that out. Keyword being healthy digestion, not cloning, so to speak. Absolutely, Cynthia. Much more succinct than I could have ever said there. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you for summarising my waffling, which I know it is. Cool. We all learn to use letters, solos. Some good points here. Brad says, when you're doing classic albums, are you playing from the tab or another source? I am listening to the songs. I make a note of the structure. And then, obviously, if it's like, if I can hear the verse repeats a few times, then I'll just go into one verse and go, you know, then I'll figure out the chord progression if it's a chord thing. And then I'll start looking at all the different parts of it, really, just figuring it out by ear. It's quite clear to me most of the time where they're playing it on the neck generally, just because I spent lots of time doing it by ear, and the knowledge of theory and things, and the kind of what the human hand can naturally do, and also learning about the player. Like, for example, I'm doing Rumours, Fleetwood Mac, so there's some stuff in there which I'm not that well versed at, like Travis picking. So that's something I'm learning to teach the course, and learning about Lindsey Buckingham's influences and things, and just that kind of helps me get a sense of how he would play things. He does a lot of stuff on single strings, so I kind of, a lot of the guesswork, this is what I'm saying about being Indiana Jones, a lot of the guesswork of archaeology, you start to kind of extrapolate where that is over time. And as I do that, I do shorthand tabs for myself written with no rhythms, just kind of things to keep a note of that. And I use a software called Transcribe where I've got a track and I can put markers on it so I know where each bit that I'm going to teach is. And then when it comes to teaching, I just bring up the listen to it. Oh yeah, it's that. And then I teach it. And then if it's something really complicated and notey, because it's a whole album, sometimes I'll just check out my reference notes there, which I've made. Now, if it's very, very weird, like a Van Halen thing, or for example, Never Going Back Again or something, I'll look at live footage closely, but only once I've spent time with it with my own ear, because otherwise I'm not really listening carefully, I'm just kind of looking. So listening is the most important thing, and then the looking kind of gives you another clue. Detective work, I love it. Cool. John, good to see you, take care. I need to sign up, I bought classic albums ordered. Nice. Yeah, if you, KT88 on Licklibrary, the membership, there are tons more lessons. Lots of the DVDs are now streamable. I think most of them, but there's also just extra stuff. There's like, you know, whole theory courses, individual song lessons. There's so much available in the membership, and I honestly don't know anywhere else, to be honest. I mean, I work for Licklibrary. I before I was a Licklibrary tutor, I spent a lot of time learning from Licklibrary before that. So, you know, it's the place to go to pick up lots of stuff. So do check it out. Do check it out. Stories and subjects have always been said before. Cool. Right. So I think Sam, guitar player, motivational speaker. Blue Sumlin, he's gone. Oh, he's gone. That's a shame. I didn't get to say goodbye. Hopefully that... I'm gonna wrap this up because it's almost been an hour. But hopefully this has been helpful. If you've just joined later on, hopefully you can rewatch and see where things are going. I'll be back. I'm actually going away on a little break for a bit, and I'll be back in March with more live streams, absolutely. And in the meantime, check all the things I said out, licklibrary.com, and just look after your playing. Have a good time. I love doing these. It's great to see some familiar faces. And yeah, it's just an absolute pleasure. And it was a great opportunity for me to kind of go back over some of my favourite solos. In fact, you know, I get the luxury now of kind of going through. You can do a thing called a learning. I think you can save on Licklibrary the courses you want to sort of look through. And I'm doing a similar thing with my own playing now. I'm kind of going through all the things I've taught for Licklibrary and going back over them again, just because it's good fun, and to maybe get some new phrases in my playing. And if you have a backlog of that stuff, if you're ever feeling a bit kind of, oh, this lick's a bit boring, or I'm not feeling that inspired, well, you can look back for your list and it's there. I've forgotten the name of it. There's a feature on Licklibrary. You can do that in your accounts. You can actually see, you know, what you've kind of bookmarked for later. So cool tool. Anyway, thank you, Julian. Much appreciated. Cynthia, thank you very much. Clarity is my new theme for this year. I think it's an ongoing theme for me, certainly. Absolutely. Good to see you. Gary, Victor, KT88, and it supports you. Yes, it does. It directly supports us. Lovely company, great players, fantastic. Pleasure to be part of. Good to see you all. Right, I am going to finish now. So it's good to see you all. I'm going to see if I can play the solo to Photograph again one more time, because it's just a cool solo. Here we go. See you later. Take care. Oh.